you would just bow your heads with me in a word of prayer. Lord, thank you so much that you are by our side. So many times, Lord, that we have walked away from you, and yet you pursue us, yet you long to be with us. And I pray, Lord Jesus, more than anything, that you would do what you can do. And what only you can do is open our eyes in your word. Help us to be reminded that you are by our side. We'll be careful, God, to give you the praise. The glory is all yours, and the victory is all yours. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, good morning, everybody. Summer is here. It is hot in the city. I'm going to sweat my way all the way through this message with great joy, because we know in 3 weeks that we'll be missing it. But it is so good to see everybody here in God's house. There's a couple things that I want to share with you as we get ready to go into this word. I pray that God's word would be an encouragement to someone today. I believe that strongholds are going to be broken in this place because of God's word, not because of my words. So maybe you're here and you have a past that you wish that you could forget. I'm glad that you're in church today. It's for you. And maybe you're here today and you struggle to forgive yourself. And if that's you, I'm glad that you're here today. But maybe you're here today and you are a judgmental person and you struggle to forgive others. I'm especially glad that you're here today, because God's word is for all of us. I wonder where you were at, if you can remember back this far, June 17th, 2015. It was a Wednesday, just a usual summer day, and people in the evening who call themselves Christians that may have churches that have Wednesday night services probably are making their way to houses of worship all over our country. But this wasn't going to be an average or ordinary evening. You see, the people that were gathering at Mother Emmanuel AME Church were gathering for Bible study, and a guest came in, because at Mother Emmanuel Church, just like us, every time they open the doors, it's someone's first Sunday. The church, one of the largest African-American churches in the country and the Southeast, and certainly one of the oldest, and they were having Bible study on Wednesday night, and a young man came in the room. He's 21 years old, and he came to sit in Bible study in a church, in a building that looks an awful lot like this. And they had Bible study, and they welcomed him and went through the Word of God. And then they closed for prayer. And as their eyes were closed, something happened that riveted the entire United States. As bullets began to rip through the flesh of those that were in attendance, 9 people were murdered praying at the end of Bible study on a Wednesday night. Who's shooting? Where is it coming from? As they dove under tables and tried to run to get out of the way, the guest who they brought in was shooting. When the shooting stopped, 9 people had been murdered and 3 have been wounded. What would you do? How would you feel if you were there in that moment and you lost your son? How would you feel in that moment if you were there and your pastor who was there encouraging the woman who was leading Bible study was murdered right in front of his wife and his 2 children? How would you feel? I know how I think that I would feel. I mean, I'm a Christian. I believe in grace and forgiveness, but can I just keep it real? I know how I would feel. And the guest was heading out, and there was one last lady under the table, and he said to her, "I'm leaving you so you can tell everybody what happened here." I don't know about you, but when I think about that story, the first thing that comes to mind is usually not Acts chapter 9, verse 26 through 31. Can I just keep it real with my brothers and sisters? That the first thing that comes to mind is not, well, let me grab the Bible and see what the Lord has to say about it, but that's exactly what I'm going to ask you to do. So I want you to grab your Bibles as we look at Barnabas, a reconciling faith. Barnabas, a reconciling faith. Now, in this text, we're going to work through it, but there's a little background that you probably should know. And because you're good cathedral students, you maybe have seen or glanced in this passage. And there are three primary characters that we're going to deal with. The first is Saul. And Saul was a government secret agent. And we're going to learn a little bit more about him in a few moments. And the second group that we're going to learn about is the disciples. And actually, to be represented more clearly, you should look at Galatians chapter 1 and 2 in your free time this week, because some time had passed. This actually is James and Peter that Saul is talking to on behalf of the disciples. And then there's a third person who is incredible, who I'd like to introduce to many of you and maybe remind some of you. His name is Barnabas. We might call him Barney occasionally for the sermon, but Barnabas is in this passage as well. So let's read God's word. As I read it, I pray that God would open not our eyes, but open our hearts as well to what he has to say for us. We're going to start at the 26th verse, as I said, and we're going to go to the 31st verse. And when he, being Saul, had come to Jerusalem, he attempted to join the disciples, and they were afraid of him, for they did not believe that he was a disciple. But Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles and declared to them how on the road he had seen the Lord, who spoke to him, and how at Damascus he had preached boldly in the name of Jesus. So he went in and out among them at Jerusalem, preaching boldly in the name of the Lord. And he spoke the disputed word against the Hellenists. And they were seeking to kill him. And when the brothers learned this, they brought him down to Caesarea and sent him off to Tarsus, which was his hometown. So the church throughout all Judea and Galilee and Samaria had peace and was being built up and walked in the fear of the Lord and in the comfort of the Holy Spirit. It multiplied. May God have a blessing to the reading of his word. The first thing I want to share with you today about reconciling faith is this. Reconciling faith believes that God works in others no matter their past. Reconciling faith believes that God can work in you and me and others no matter what our past is. It's important to understand what's going on in chapter 9, because if you don't understand what's going on, you can't appreciate these few verses. That in the first three verses of chapter 9, we find out that Saul is an OG. For those that need translation in the Greek, that's original gangster. That's who Paul is. Paul was the man among men. He, for fun, terrorized Christians. He asked for permission to go into places and kill believers. So Saul, in the early part of the chapter, has gone and asked for permission to go to Damascus. And why does he want to go to Damascus, does the text reveal? The text reveals he wants to go to Damascus so he can kill the disciples and he can take up anyone who are people of the way and take them to jail. Now, I don't know about you all, but I grew up in the African-American community. And by the looks, some of you didn't. And that's okay. It's all right. When we see an original gangster show up, there's a couple things that we do. If we're packing, we resist. If we're not, we run. We're not staying to stick around to see what's going on. We're not walking up going, oh, wow, what kind of gun do you have? Oh, you showed up at the park today. I don't know you. No, no, that's not us. We're ready to go. And Saul was ready to go to cause and wreak havoc on the church. But the text continues, and something dramatic happens to Saul. Earlier in chapter 9, God himself intervenes. And when you have some time, I encourage you to read the text. God, just strolling on the earth, decides to knock Paul, who is not his name yet, Saul, off of his horse. And he says, why are you persecuting me? What's up, bro? Why do you keep doing this to me? He was such a first-class sinner that God himself had to come down into human history and knock him off his horse. That's how successful Saul was. And Saul looks and goes, Lord, is it you? How does he know to say Lord? And the Bible declares that God tells Saul, I want you to get up. I want you to go into Damascus. And there's a guy named Ananias. I love how clear that God is. He didn't ask his opinion about how he felt. He didn't ask his opinion about being blinded, because God can do whatever he wants to do. But what he said is, you're going to go and see somebody named Ananias, and he'll give you more direction. So here the men take Saul into town, and they run into Ananias. And I love Ananias' response as we move through the text. Ananias hears from God, and God tells him what he's going to do. And Ananias responds to God and says, hey, God, hey, do you know who that is? Bruh, I mean, you're going to tell me to go talk to Saul? I know his reputation. I know what he does with God's people. Don't you want to send somebody else? Here I am, Lord. Send Thomas. I mean, I'm just Ananias, dude. I'm just trying to serve you, be faithful. And the Bible declares that God tells him, go. Go do what I told you to do. And he did. And then we run into Paul. Now his name still is Saul. He wanted to join the disciples. See, he had been terrorizing people for so long, and now he finds himself and he doesn't have community. He's come to Jesus and he's a disciple, but he doesn't have any community or family around him. Was that any of your testimony, that when you came to Jesus, you didn't have any peeps that loved Jesus around you? And you found yourself alone and you were just looking for a place, just looking for a place to belong before I believe. I'm looking for a place that I can call home. And he's wanting to be with the disciples. Of course, the disciples, Peter and James, would receive him. Of course, they would receive him as their brother in Christ. I mean, after all, they've been delivered from Jesus. And after all, Peter, you've actually sinned the greatest. I mean, there has to be a reality here that grace is going to abound. But the Bible tells us in verse 26 that there was a different response. It says that the disciples were all afraid of him and didn't believe that he was a believer. Now, before we hate on the disciples, before we get all self-righteous and say, well, who do they think that they are? That is terrible. I mean, who do they think they are, not allowing somebody into the body of Christ after what Jesus Christ, before you get self-righteous, we should at least acknowledge that fear is not the absence of faith. We should at least acknowledge that there's a little bit of back history, you see, because the disciples had appointed a man named Stephen who was a deacon. In two chapters earlier, we find out that Stephen proclaims the word of God with great power. And what happens to him for his good pleasure? They run him out of town and they stone him to death. And as they're stoning him, he looks up to heaven and he says, "Father, forgive them for what they're doing." And then he went to meet our Lord and Savior. The person who said, "You can execute him," was Saul. There's a reason why they were afraid. There's a reason why they had great, great, great tension in their hearts. And it reminds me that reconciliation costs you something. Reconciliation costs you something. You don't have reconciling faith for free. Reconciling faith will cost you something. The disciples didn't believe Saul was a believer. Have any of you ever believed that some of your friends are not believers? Keep looking at me. Don't look to the left or right. Please don't. Just look at me. Have you ever seen somebody who Jesus has brought to himself, and the truth is in your heart, you're like, "No, ain't no way. No. No. I knew that brother. No, uh-uh. He cheated on me and three other people. There's no way that he knows Jesus. No, I know what they did to our family. There's absolutely no way that they're a believer. No, I saw how much she drank because I was with her, and I just know that there's no way." Now, don't leave me out here. Any of y'all been like that? Thank you for the 14 people that know Jesus Christ in this room. But some of us understand when we look at family and we look at friends, we don't have faith that they've received faith. And the disciples are right there. I love how Erwin McManus says it. He says, "Love never comes without wounds, and faith never comes without fear." Love never comes without wounds, and faith never comes without fear. There was real fear in the room at this moment as Saul is coming trying to find help, and the help is looking at him going, "Dude, we don't know if we're going to let you in the club." God's grace is not determinant on your acceptance. He sets the standards, not you. Is not determined and determinant on your acceptance. He sets the standards, not you. Aren't you glad that you're not? I'm so glad that you're not God and that I'm not God. I'm so glad that God doesn't give up on us. I'm so glad that God gives us 69 and 102nd chances. I'm so glad that God doesn't see my past and holds it against me, but he sees my past as a platform for my future. I'm so glad that God doesn't hold my past against me. And maybe that's your testimony. Maybe you're sitting here and you don't understand that God often confirms your potential in private before he reveals it in public. God often confirms your potential in private before he reveals it in public. Saul had a private, pretty dramatic moment. But something was about ready to happen in public. It had been 3 years since early in chapter 9 to this moment in verse 27 that we're getting ready to look at. 3 years that he had been walking faithfully and preaching the gospel, but not near the disciples. And so he's coming trying to find community because the Hellenists had already run him out and were angry with him. And it leads us to the second point of the sermon, that reconciling faith proclaims God's work in others, no matter the risk. Reconciling faith proclaims God's work in others, no matter the risk. I told you there were three groups of people, and we've examined two, but there's a brother that comes on the scene. And ladies, I want you to listen very clearly to the next 3 minutes. Because there's a brother named Barnabas who shows up. And Barnabas isn't just an average brother. Barnabas, when he speaks, everybody listens. When Barnabas began to speak, he understood two things. One, I have something to say. And two, I'm putting everything in my reputation on the line with what I'm getting ready to say. In verse 27, it says this, but Barnabas. Man, I could just preach right there, but Barnabas. There's a contrast, there's a line that something, Barnabas wants to tell you about a but, and we're going to listen. And he says this very thing, that he took him, he brought him to the apostles, and he declared to them how on the road he had seen the Lord. Why should everybody listen to Barnabas? Well, thank you. I'm glad, Tara, that you asked. I'm going to share just a couple of things right here. Why we should listen. The Bible lets us know three things about Barnabas that we should take note of. In chapter 4, verse 37, you can just write it in your margin, we find out that Barnabas was a generous man. He had sold a plot of land that he had and gave every dime of it to the disciples to fund part of their ministry. Barnabas was a generous man. But it didn't stop there. I love in chapter 11, verse 24, we find out three things about Barnabas. The Bible says that Barnabas was a good man. Isn't it awesome? I just love that. He was a good man. He wasn't just a good man. Second thing was, he was full of the Holy Spirit. Barnabas was full of the Holy Spirit. And the third thing was, Barnabas was full of faith. Ladies, it's not even in my notes. I'm just going to take this right here. How many ladies that are here are single? One day, when God's timing is right, you want a man. Just raise your hand. Just raise your hand. Tell the truth. Shame the devil. It's all good. It's all, thank you. Thank you for honesty in God's house. Can't stand people that are just like, I don't know. No, you do know. You either have a gift to be single or you don't. Here is a list for a man. Loves Jesus. Full of faith. He's a good man. And he mentors people. He sold out for Jesus Christ. You want a man? Go to chapter 9. Go to chapter 11 and hang out there for a few years. And don't let any trifling man come to you that doesn't have those qualities. Amen? Ladies, I thought y'all would just shout me down right there. I should probably get back to the sermon. One of the things that I love about Barnabas is Barnabas is a leader who develops other leaders. The Bible lets us know that he mentored two people, Paul, and he also mentored a person, John Mark. Mark and Paul that he discipled. Well, there's five characteristics of a leader maker that I've adapted from something that John Piper shared years ago that I just hope is a gift to you. If you are looking to be a leader maker, what are five characteristics that you should have? The first is risk-taking. You can't be a leader without taking risks on somebody else. He took a great risk of putting his reputation on the line for somebody who had a reputation of being a first-class sinner. When's the last time you put your reputation on the line for somebody that nobody else believed in? But the second thing is, you can identify talent and you celebrate them. You can identify talent, but you celebrate them. One of my favorite things to do in ministry is to find people who are full of the Holy Spirit and hype them up and give them opportunities to be able to lead. He spent a year with Saul later in Acts, discipling him and mentoring him. And then he celebrated him because he turned in chapter 13, he turned and he became the person that Saul, who became Paul, was leading. You know, some people are very interesting as I study scripture because they can't do the third thing. They can't be humble and share shine. Be humble. It's not just a rap song. Be humble and help other people shine. It's not about you. We don't have to have the spotlight on yourself. Put the spotlight on somebody else and help them shine and bring out the gifts that God has given them. But the fourth thing is, be patient with the failures of others. Wow. Be patient with the failures of others. I just celebrated an anniversary last month. I'm so glad that Marcia is patient with me. I mean, y'all should just definitely give God thanks for that girl. She's just patient with me. Thank you for the four people that really, thank you. Thank you. What if my wife wasn't patient with me when I made mistakes? Do you think we'd be married 24 years? It's not perfect. It had highs and lows. But I thank God that when you're making a leader, you have to be patient with their failures. If I was standing and telling you today that I understand everything that Barnabas and the disciples were feeling in this moment, I would be a liar. I've been in some rough situations. I've seen some things that are not pleasant. But most of us don't have the testimony of somebody walking in and taking your family member and killing them. Most of us don't have the testimony of someone busting in the door and taking a family member out of the house, out of the safety and security of your home, like many people are facing today in our country. No, it's not a political sermon. I'm just telling you, we don't have that experience. But Saul stepped up and he spoke up. And I love the last thing, is that if you're going to be a leader maker, you need to be full of generosity. You got to be full of generosity. You must have a generous heart toward other people. Stingy people don't make it far in the world. And they certainly don't make it far in the kingdom. And I'm not just talking about money, but I'm talking about time. I'm talking about skills and our efforts and our gifts. I'm talking about just being present and listening. What does it mean to be full of generosity? Love is inconvenient, I'm learning in my life. True love is inconvenient. And the Bible tells us that Barnabas did three things. He didn't just speak up on behalf of Saul, but he did three things. He took him, he had to go and find him and got him and said, "You need to come with me, bruh. We're going to go see the disciples because I see something in you that you don't see yet in yourself. I see that you are going to be the person who God is going to use to bring Gentiles the gospel. I see that you have gifts that nobody else in this room has. I need you to come with me." He took him, but he didn't just take him. The Bible says that he brought him to Peter and James. He brought him to them. And then the Bible says that he declared to them. He spoke up on behalf of what Saul had experienced. He told the testimony of what God had done to him along the way, and he vouched for him. Notice, as Pastor Jeff and I were talking and looking at this text this week, notice what's not said in the text. Does Barnabas say anything about his past? No. Does Barnabas say anything about his family? Does he say anything about Stephen and what happened two chapters before that they all knew about? He didn't say anything about his past. For you who are here today who are struggling with guilt in your past, I'm here to tell you by the authority of Jesus Christ, your past is not determining your future. Your past is just that. It's facts. Your future is determined by the Holy Spirit and His grace. So if you're here and you're a person who are struggling with your past, you're struggling with things that are in your life that you wish that nobody knew about, I'm telling you that God wants to take your past and use it as an offering to him. Everybody knew who Saul was, and he was going to have to pay for that. Everybody knew what he had done to believers who loved Jesus Christ. But Jesus knew that Paul had truly been saved for real. And the Bible lets us know that after he said yes to him, he immediately went and got baptized. He didn't think about it. He didn't have a task force to think about things. He went, got baptized, and immediately went to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. What about you? What is it that you, God has called you uniquely to do, but you've stopped doing it because you can't forgive yourself? God is saying, you are forgiven. Nobody holds faith against you. You're forgiven, but you have to act on it. Reconciling faith chooses to see what others refuse to see and speaks what others don't have courage to declare. It came out so strong when I was studying that phrase. Reconciling faith chooses to see what others refuse to see and speaks what others don't have courage to declare. It's hard to reconcile with someone who's hurt you. It's not easy. It's hard to look at somebody in the eyes who's caused you so much pain and turn around and say, I forgive you. But the Bible lets us know that the disciples had information about Saul. But Barnabas had love for Saul. Some of us have information on people and data, but we don't have love for them. The Bible says that Barnabas had love for Saul, and that's the reason why he responded. Maybe he understood how he had been forgiven. Maybe he looked in the proverbial mirror that morning and understood, oh, but for the grace of God would I be Saul. Maybe he understood that he's been forgiven, and because he's been forgiven, much is required, and that he's going to have to stand in the gap to make sure a brother is saved. What about you? Who is God calling you to stand in the gap for? I love this quote by Bob Goff. It will be people with the greatest love, not the most information, who will influence us change. It'll be people who have the greatest love. People that have the most information don't help me. They get me a certain point of the way. But the people who have love, unbelievable, unconditional love, they help me in the times of greatest struggle. I want you to write down the name of somebody in your life who's shown you unconditional love when you haven't deserved it. Right now, I want you to just write that down in the margin. You don't have to write my name down, just somebody else. Somebody else. Just make sure. I want you to write that name down. And this is the third point today. Reconciling faith releases God's work through others for multiplied fruit. Reconciling faith releases God's work through others for multiplied fruit. Imagine after Saul had heard Barnabas talk about him, how he felt. Can you imagine just the encouragement in his heart? Just imagine that you're standing there and somebody's talking about you like that. And you didn't have any place to belong. And now someone's speaking on your behalf. Let's see how the Bible says that Saul responded. So he went in and out among them at Jerusalem, preaching boldly in the name of the Lord. And he spoke and disputed against the Hellenists, but they were seeking to kill him. There's always haters in the story. Who were Hellenists? They were Greek-speaking Jews, and they were really upset. And why were they upset? It's because just a few weeks ago, in this context, 3 years, Paul was their ride or die. He was the one that they went to. Let's go kill some people, man. Let's go. That's what they did. This is what we do. We're Jews of Jews. And Jesus Christ is not the truth. He's fake. And Paul, you were the one who used to ride with us, and now we want to kill you. Oh, well, praise the Lord. I'm so glad I'm in the club. I go preach the gospel, and they want to kill me again. They want to run me out of town. But I'm so glad that the Bible lets us know that Saul did not cower to fear. He went and he preached the gospel. He went to be who God had called him to be, amen? He knew that Jesus Christ in him was more powerful than anything that was outside of him. It's amazing what can happen when someone believes in you, isn't it? As I was studying this week, I thought of my friend Adam, the church that I was in Nashville. He would sit in the second seat right behind me every week. Adam would hug me, and he loved to violate personal space as much as I did. And so he just was an amazing young man. Adam was special needs. And his mom came to me a year after I had been at the church. And she used to sit up in the balcony, and she'd watch what was going on every Sunday. And she'd watch how Adam would give me a hug every Sunday. And she would watch at the end when it was time for prayer. Every Sunday, Adam, before it could even get out, Adam, Pastor Ray, would you pray for me? Yes, Adam, I would love to pray for you. And Adam, would you pray for me? Actually, would you pray for me? I found out from his mom, she came down one Sunday after church, and she said, with tears in her eyes, thank you for loving my son. I'm just thinking, I'm just, you know, showing the love of Jesus Christ to me. Adam sits next to me every Sunday. Why, oh, why is she sharing this? Well, the last church that they were at, they asked she and her son to leave the church because he had hugged someone and she had reported it to the pastor. Before we get self-righteous and start talking about some people and what they've gone through, I understand that. But a church asked a young man and his mother never to come back to the church again, and that's how he came to our church. That's how he ended up behind me, encouraging me, reminding me of why I'm in the church. I'm not here for people to know my name. I'm here to love people like Adam. And you are too. Who is it that you need to believe in and speak up for and to show grace to? For the first time, somebody had believed in Adam in church. Haters are always trying to steal our shine. But you know what? Satan doesn't bother people who aren't on mission. Maybe you're sitting here and you're like, Ed, I don't have those kind of problems. I mean, Satan is just, it's not bothering me. My life's all good. Well, maybe you should check yourself. Because Satan doesn't mess with people that aren't worthy to be messed with. Not proclaiming the gospel, no need to mess with you. Being incognito at work, no need to mess with you. Nobody in your building knows that you love the Lord. Nobody needs to mess with you. You're already doing the best job that he could ever ask, which is be quiet and don't share anything about the gospel of Jesus Christ. But maybe you're like our friend Saul, where we're going to end it today in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Verse 17. 30 years later, we catch up with Saul, and his name has been changed. And this is what he writes. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. 30 years later, Barnabas is gone to be with the Lord. And Paul says, we all have the ministry of reconciliation. We started the day talking about an amazing church and some great people who suffered amazing tragedy. Dylan Roof is the name of the young man who shot up the church. Dylan's loved by God. 48 hours after, there was a bond hearing in town that was broadcast around the United States. Every family got up and said to Dylan, we forgive you. May Jesus Christ have mercy on your soul. What kind of faith does that? What kind of faith forgives somebody who murders your husband right in front of you? What kind of faith forgives racism? What kind of faith forgives people who don't understand immigration policy? What kind of faith helps people understand that Jesus Christ is greater than the greatest pain that I've ever experienced? Who do you need to forgive? Who do you need to forgive? Who do you need to speak up for, so that they know that Jesus Christ is everything? Who do you need to remind that he can do it again? That Jesus Christ can do it again in your life and in your life and in your life. Jesus Christ can do it again. And so I want you to stand as we sing and we proclaim to the heavens that Jesus Christ can do it again in our lives. Amen. Let's stand and let's worship the Lord Jesus.